granted. It is foolish, for the opposite of wisdom is what? Someone say foolishness. If you want to know what is the opposite or what is diametrically opposed to wisdom, principle, wisdom in spirit, and wisdom in personification, and wisdom in institution. Institutional wisdom is the church. The personification of wisdom is Jesus Christ. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. A graduation cap. I've had surgery on my scalp. Vanity surgery. Someone say vanity surgery. That means it was cosmetic. It was not intrusive. It was to improve the facade of the house, and it simply had no spiritual value whatsoever. Can the church say amen? Someone say, tell the truth and shame the devil. And tonight, as we apologize for the having to wear the cap until the resurgence of the natural follicles within the confines of the crown, then we will simply have to deal with this until we're in a position to present ourselves in a better light. And apologies to my television audience who may be looking at me and frowning at my disfigured visage. Remember, the scriptures found in the 53rd chapter of the book of Isaiah that said there was no form or comeliness with regard to Jesus Christ, and there was no beauty to be desired of him. Can we say amen? So it is not in the looks. It is in the substance of spirituality. Turn to someone and say, it is not in the looks, but in the substance of spirituality. On the night, my understanding is Prince Nelson passed away, and of course, I have no comment on his life, and as much as he was not a member of the body of Christ as we know it. And then the scripture says in one place, who art thou that judgeth another man's servant? To his own master he standeth, and to his own master he falleth. Simply will make the point that he did belong to the world, and the Bible says of the world loves its own. He was of the world, he was in the world, and of course, it is unfortunate that the world is only concerned about his gift and his artistry, no concern about his spirituality. No reference to his soul, no care for his eternal substance whatsoever. All the discussions are so selfish on the part of the media and those who are commenting as to what he meant to them in terms of entertaining them and making them feel good within themselves. How selfish the world is. We should be concerned about the souls of men. Can the church say amen? And their disposition with respect to where they stand in, not the sight of man, which seems to be the preoccupation of those who are discussing this unfortunate circumstance, but in fact, where people stand in the sight of God. Prince was a artist that influenced the life of Denise Matthews, who preached here twice. Denise Matthews was, in fact, a very good gospel preacher in terms of her testimony. She had a powerful testimony concerning her conversion, her hearing, believing and obeying the gospel. My understanding that she was converted through the ministry of a former NFL Hall of Famer, that is Willie Harper, who played football in the NFL for the San Francisco 49ers. It is my understanding that he was instrumental in her baptism in Jesus' name, that is Denise Matthews, and her being filled with the Holy Spirit, her coming out of that lifestyle and arena within the confines of the entertainment world. She spoke in her testimony of many things that pertain to the social and, shall we say, philosophical behavior of those persons who live in that world, who abuse substances or had substance abuse problems, whether they be legal or illegal prescription drugs. This obviously took its toll on Denise. She passed away earlier this year, and she certainly had the testimony that she gave diligence to make her calling and her election sure. She was a preacher of the gospel. She testified to the like precious faith that you and I have enjoyed and do enjoy to this day. And my understanding is from the account given by her pastor, she died in Christ. I cannot speak to the state of Prince Nelson. I can only say that he is in the hands of God, as we all are. But one scripture says, no man liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. Whether we live unto the Lord, or whether we die unto the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's, which means that we are in the hands of a just God, and he is, within his sovereignty, able to do whatever he desires to do with us. And, of course, he has entered into a covenant with us, made promises to do unto us that which is goodly as long as we are faithful unto death. Can the church say amen? Hence, someone say, be faithful unto death, and we shall receive a crown of life. Now, tonight, again, I have already explained why I'm wearing this very unusual costume, and so hopefully you will not hold it against me. We're calling your attention to the 9th chapter of the book of Proverbs. We are revisiting a subject for the simplicity of Impact Television so that we will be able to share on Impact Television a subject that deals with a systematic subject and topic known as the 7 pillars of wisdom. In the framework of working a topic, a theme, a subject within the scientific exegesis. Someone say exegesis, where we exegese or thoroughly work the text in its context on a certain theme. Tonight, we are dealing with the house of wisdom, the 7 pillars of wisdom. Can the church say amen? And they are found in Proverbs chapter 9, verses number 1 through 6. We should begin on the subject by giving you what those 7 pillars of wisdom are. The subject is the house of wisdom. The complete subject is the 7 pillars of wisdom. But these 7 pillars of wisdom are related to the subject of the house of wisdom. Wisdom, defined from a theological standpoint, is the ability to deal sagaciously with facts, or simplified for the listeners on tonight, both in television and in the congregation, wisdom is the ability to use the knowledge of God found in the 66 books of the Bible, and the understanding of that knowledge found in the 66 books of the Bible to the glory of God or to perfection. Please make a note of that for the tape. It is the ability, once again, to take the knowledge of God, no logos. Knowledge is a compound word, no logos. Logos being the word of God, and the knowledge having the insight into that word, the no logos of the knowledge of God, theos, and the understanding of no logos, theos, and using it to the glory of God, or to perfection, or to the completion, or to the end in which God designed for that knowledge to be understood and to be used. So this is why I simply say to all of you that are here tonight on what is referred to as family night, you are very wise if you are here to receive instruction in the knowledge of God. You are very foolish if you will contend with the bishop of the diocese and the pastor with regard to him trying to instruct you as to what the fathers have handed to us to hand to you so that you can be taken on to perfection. You cannot finish your course if you will not submit yourself to the knowledge of God and to getting an understanding of that knowledge. And how is God going to make that knowledge available to you? According to Jeremiah 3:15, he said, I will give you pastors according to mine own heart who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. So you're not going to get it unless you get it God's way. And the way you get it God's way is you follow the instruction of the fathers who gave what they gave to us to give to you. You get here, you sit to receive the instruction from the word of God as it is rightly divided, and then you take such instruction, and it is not the hearers of the word that are just before God, but it is the doers of the work. So you and I then go and do as we have been instructed out of the knowledge of God and with the understanding God has given us through the pastor to do. It is as simple as that. I've made that statement to so many people who want to know about my natural and spiritual success, both as a bishop in the POW, as well as in the business world, in the kingdom of man, and I explain to them all the time. My success is attributed specifically to the fact that I follow the instruction of my fathers. My father in the gospel, I was saved under the late Bishop David Lee Ellis. I followed his instruction. My father as the bishop of the diocese was the late Bishop Ross Perry Paddock, followed by the late Bishop Willie Burroughs Sr., followed by Bishop Harry L. Herman. I followed all of their instruction. I did what they instructed me to do all the time, every time. And so I've been blessed because the Bible says, if you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. And God cannot lie. So because of my faithfulness to my predecessors and the forefathers, then I reap the benefits. If one will refuse to do such, then they have to suffer the consequences. If they do as the word of God has said do, they will reap the benefits, as God is without respect of persons. So now wisdom. Wisdom in precept is the word of God. We talk about wisdom as a precept or principle. It's the word of God. Wisdom from a spiritual standpoint is the spirit of God or the spirit of Christ. Because in 1 Corinthians 1:24, it says, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Wisdom personified is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the personification of wisdom. The house of wisdom is the New Testament church. And of course, a type of that, an example of that church would be the Old Testament church or the church in the wilderness. So this is the outline I wanted to give you on tonight so that you will not take, someone say, wisdom for granted. it is foolish, for the opposite of wisdom is what? Someone say foolishness. If you want to know what is the opposite or what is diametrically opposed to wisdom, the principle, wisdom in spirit, and wisdom in personification, and wisdom in institution. Institutional wisdom is the church. The personification of wisdom is Jesus Christ. The precept of wisdom are the principles of the Word of God. The spirit of wisdom is the spirit of Christ. So what is opposed to that? Someone say foolishness. And the foolishness I'm referring to is individuals who act as though they do not know what the Word of God says when they're supposed to know, or individuals who refuse to do what the Word of God says when they do have a knowledge of what is required of them and just will not obey. Now then, wisdom. In verse number 1, let us read out loud together as is our custom, through verse number 6, in the 9th chapter of the book of Proverbs. Wisdom hath builded her house. She hath hewn out her 7 pillars. She hath killed her beast. She hath mingled her wine. She hath also furnished her table. She hath sent forth her maidens. She crieth upon the highest places of the city. Who is simple, let him turn in hither. As for him that wanteth or lacketh understanding, she saith to him, come, eat of my bread and drink of the wine which I have mingled. Verse 6, forsake the foolish and live and go in the way of understanding. Can the church say amen? So verse number 1, wisdom hath builded her house. Someone say the church. This is speaking to the New Testament church today, which is the fulfillment of the building of the house of wisdom. She hath hewn out her 7 pillars, the term 7, the number 7 being the number of completion in the scriptures. Can the church say amen? And so let's keep that in mind. The number of completion is 7. You study that in your spare time. That's not our subject tonight. Simply want to know the set term 7 is pertaining to the completion of the house of wisdom being built upon 7 pillars. And what then are those 7 pillars? Now the 7 pillars. Verse 2, she have killed her beast, is pillar number 1. And of course, she have mingled her wine, is pillar number 2. She have also furnished her table, is pillar number 3. She have sent forth her maidens, is pillar number 4. She crieth, TH, upon the highest places of the city, is pillar number 5. And what is her she crying? Whoso is simple, let him turn in hither. Pillar number 6, as for him that lack of understanding, she saith to him, come eat of my bread and drink of wine which I have mingled. That's pillar number 6. And then finally in verse number 6, pillar number 7, forsake the foolish and live and go in the way of understanding. Now if my video persons are keeping a note, I want them to pay close attention to make sure they outline these pillars accurately on television for the television audience. Now, when you think in terms of her hewing out her 7 pillars, she has hewn out her 7 pillars. And this is the question you want to ask me with respect to a scripture. How is it that wisdom have killed her beast, mingled her wine, and have furnished her table? The first thing we want to speak to is that she has hewn out her 7 pillars. Is there scripture to prove that wisdom has hewn out her 7 pillars? Let's go to Isaiah chapter 9, and then we'll move into the other 7 pillars. This is what she has done. What has she done? Hewn out. She has carved out her 7 pillars. So let's go to Isaiah 9. Praise the Lord. In verses number 8, 9, and 10. If you have it, can you say amen? Let's read. The Lord sent a word into Jacob or Jacob. Let's read out loud, everyone. And it have lighted upon Israel. Now, who sent the word? And what did it do? It lighted, it set upon Israel, or gave light unto Israel. So this is, these are the same people, Jacob and Israel. Verse 9, read, and all the people shall know, even Ephraim, who is the type of the backslider, read, and the inhabitant of Samaria, that's the Jews that intermarried with Assyrians, became known as Samaritans, read, that say in the pride and stoutness of heart, read, the bricks are falling down. Please underline that. The bricks that are falling down is, someone say, Israel. Israel is, in this text, the bricks that are falling down. Israel had failed God at this point, and they were going into what became known as Assyrian captivity. Some 200,000 of them, when you study Dr. Haley's handbook on history, Bible history, had gone into captivity. So verse 10, the bricks are falling down. If we were to translate that, Israel has failed God. Read, but we will build with hewn stone. So hewn stones are stones that have been cut out, and they still are using, though they're using modern equipment today, and they're quarrying stone to build with, it still has to be hewn out. It still has to be cut out of the quarries where they find it. So this is simply speaking to this ancient custom of going into quarries in the Middle East and finding stone that was utilizable in development, and having men who were trained to use instruments that were necessary in this area of construction to hew or to cut the stone so that it would fit in its place in the construction of the buildings that were being built in that day. Though this is a spiritual prophecy, But we will build with hewn stone. So what was written in Proverbs, wisdom have builded her house. She has what? She have hewn out her what? Her seven pillars. This is a prophecy that we will build with what? Hewn stone. And this building will go on in the house of wisdom, as it was said in the ninth chapter of the book of Proverbs. And if you did not know it, it's going on right now. You and I are lively stones. That's who we are. We are built up a what? The Bible said we're lively stones, built up a spiritual house. I guess you don't know your Bible anymore. You allow the scriptures to get away that quick. And I thought you had the Holy Ghost. I guess some of you still do. All right, so verse 10, the bricks are falling down, but we will build with hewn stones. The sycamores are cut down, but we will change them into cedars. Now, this verse 10 has come to pass in the church dispensation. We're taking each of these particular scriptures in the ninth chapter of Proverbs and trying to give you the sense of them to let you see this is a building process. And for you to think that you can stay home and watch Grimm's Fairy Tales, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, and some of the other cartoons, The Simpsons and all this, when you need to be in the church with us, building up yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, and keeping yourself in the love of God is a misconception. You need to understand you have just as much responsibility in this process as I do. we will build with what? Hewn stone. So get yourself the Bible class out there in my television audience and you here tonight and get in service. Now some say, well, I don't go to the Bible class because it's boring. You know, you should get there so that you can be faithful to God. Your alms should be not to Bishop Combs or to your pastor. Your alms should be to God. And he will recognize your faithfulness and give a word to your pastor or whoever you're under that is necessary for you to be taken on to, someone say, perfection. Now, this is not all. Let's go further now to, let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2, I think it is. Amen. Let's go to Peter, and that's that scripture. Ye then as lively what? Stones. I thought that was 1 Peter chapter 2, though. It is, isn't it? It's chapter 5? No, it's chapter 2. It is. It's all right. So now this is us. Turn to someone and say, this is us, child. This is speaking to the New Testament church. When the first epistle general of the Apostle Peter, he was the first presiding bishop of the New Testament church. He was the spokesperson for the apostles. He was the one of the chiefs of the apostles, the senior man among the apostles, and the man given the keys to the kingdom, which was the gospel of Jesus Christ, which he used on Pentecost. He used 8 years later with the Samaritans. He used 10 years later in the 10th chapter of the book of Acts with the Gentiles. Can the church say amen? He is writing to not only the strangers who were saved and scattered through Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, not only the elect according to the foreknowledge of God through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, but he's writing to the members of the greater Bible Way Temple of the Apostolic Faith and those of you in my television audience who have been the recipients of eternal salvation. So he says now in verse number 1 down through verse number 6. Let's read. Wherefore, laying aside all malice. Now, this is what we have. Turn to someone and say, this is what we have to do. See, some things God will do for us, and then some things we have to do for ourselves. So this is what we have to do. For this reason, which is referring to the preceding verses in chapter 1, laying aside all malice, reading on, and all guile, and hypocrisies, and envies, and all evil speaking. So these are the things we have to lay aside. Malice, guile, hypocrisies, envies, and evil speaking. This is what we have to do. Let's get rid of that. Then we're in a position when we unlearn and stop practicing these things. Verse number 2, as newborn babes. This is what we should do once we are saved. We are recipients of salvation. We as newborn babes, you know, I'm not a babe, I'm a bishop. But I was a babe at one time and I had to do this very thing that we're going through in the scripture. If you're a babe, or if you were a babe and you're still in need, that one teach you the first